Today we're talking about undocumented immigration solutions. And no, I'm not talking about the recent agreement Trump made with Mexico that's so good he's not releasing any details. You know, he's generally known for such modesty in the face of success. Also, talk about an undocumented immigration solution. I'm sure it's a fine detail, but I'm not going to talk about it until it's on the desk in front of me. Instead, this is a four-part show. First, we're talking about the problem and how acting Department of Homeland Security chief and Sims character before you make any changes to it, Kevin McAleenan just testified before Congress laying out the problem. Then we're going to talk about the three potential solutions we see. Specifically, a Lindsey Graham proposal, a Ted Cruz proposal, and, well, Democrats haven't actually proposed a solution yet. But don't worry, I pieced together a Frankenstein's monster of Democratic policy based on sound bites. Before we get to solutions, though, what's the problem?
U.S. authorities arrested more than 132,000 undocumented immigrants at the border last month. That's about 4,000 people a day.
If that sounds high, it is. I mean, we're back to pre-recession levels. Hey, made America great again. The biggest problem is, and I never thought we'd be nostalgic for it, but the good old days of single Mexican males coming over to take our jobs is over. Now it's mostly asylum seekers. Apparently, a bureaucracy so bad it would give Kafka nightmares is still preferable to raising a family in a war zone. While we have systems set up to expedite the deportation of able-bodied people looking for work, all of those laws get thrown out of the window with one magic word: asylum. The first debate is, do we hold detained immigrants up to the point of their trial to make sure they show up?
We're trying to do catch and hold, catch and not release. But you have to release, so we release. And they go into our country, and then you announce, these are the laws. Then you say, come back in 3 years for your trial. Tell me, what percentage of people come back? Would you say 100%? No, you're a little off. Like, how about 2%?
2%? Try more like between 57 and 76% of all non-detained people show up. Which, okay, well, I was definitely expecting something a little more dramatic in either direction from that number. But still, that's consistently over half. That statistic from a 2016 Department of Justice report was the most cited information on this discussion, until McAleenan's testimony today.
What percentage of the people show up for the asylum hearing?
So it depends on the demographic, the court, but we do see too many cases where people are not showing up. We did an expedited pilot with family units this year with ICE and the immigration courts. Out of those 7,000 cases, 90 received final orders of removal in absentia, 90%.
90% did not show up?
Correct.
Well, that's not good. That updated statistic would lead some Republicans to say, we need to spare no expense in housing and feeding every asylum-seeking man, woman, and child until their day in court. Don't have to change too many words there to make it sound like an incredibly liberal policy. Of course, there are two problems here. First, there are just too many people coming into this country to hold. It's gotten so bad that ICE Union sent a scathing letter to Trump calling for Border Patrol to release migrants directly to clear space. And when ICE is telling you to detain fewer people, that's when you know you might have a problem. That's like the Department of Homeland Security saying, we could stand to be a little less secure. I mean, come on, do we really still have to make people take their shoes off? That was one guy and we caught him! Because of this overcrowding, we've seen every level of the detention process just letting people go. This brings us to our other major obstacle. You legally cannot detain a child for more than 20 days. Our old solution was, let's just let the kids out of the detention centers then. Sounds reasonable. Until anyone realized that we have a name for that policy: family separation. So now we have to detain families and keep them together. This is getting complicated. As Lindsey Graham pointed out in a question during McAleenan's testimony that really turned into a lecture on all the great things Lindsey Graham knows.
If you bring a small child with you, Since we don't want to separate families under the Flores decision, we've got 20 days to process the claim. We don't have bed space to hold all the families, so we turn them loose by the thousands.
Great. He brought a prop for his question. This should be quick. With that explanation of the problem, we can start talking about the solutions. First, South Carolina senator and man whose every picture looks like he's saying, "Did you take the picture yet?" How would he end the crisis? Well, let's crack open Lindsey Graham's Secure and Protect Act of 2019 to find out. First, on behalf of all congressional reporters out there, 25 pages long. Your brevity is much appreciated. The first thing this does is the Secretary of Homeland Security may detain any alien minor for not more than 100 days pending the completion of removal proceedings. Now that might sound restrictive, but remember that bar is currently at 20 days, so we're actually giving ourselves an additional almost 3 months of leeway that we can hold families and minors. So you might be asking yourself, we're already having massive problems holding all these people. How are we going to hold more of them for longer periods? Well, never fear, because Lindsey Graham is pulling a reverse DACA. Instead of...
And that's why we're going to keep focusing enforcement resources on actual threats to our security. Felons, not families.
Now we have... The director of the Executive Office for Immigration Review shall prioritize the removal proceedings of an alien minor or a family unit that includes an alien minor. Great. That should actually solve the problem of having to hold families for very long periods. If you're not convinced he's solved the problem yet, it also liberalizes regulations on what can be classified as a family detention center in three ways. First, the Secretary of Homeland Security shall determine, in the sole discretion of the Secretary, the conditions of the detention available to an alien minor. If passed, these conditions will not be subject to judicial review. Let's hope Mikkelinen likes kids. It also says that a state may not require an immigration detention facility to be licensed by the state or any political subdivision thereof. With those two changes, a few memos from Mikkelinen could open the door to a ton of new facilities being family-friendly, without actually changing anything. Just lowering the bar. I mean, it's not like the federal government is gonna start cutting corners on detention centers to start holding more families. Okay, so we can hold families for longer, have opened the door to new places to hold those families, and are prioritizing the deportation of families legally. But wait, there's more. It amends the rules for declaring asylum so that immigrants can only apply at ports of entry. Now some of you, like me, might be having a small existential crisis right now, because just a few months ago the Supreme Court said,
"In a major setback for President Trump, the Supreme Court on Friday struck down his administration's request to prohibit asylum for people who crossed the US border illegally."
Does not compute, does not compute! Never fear, I'm here to bring order to the world. What the Supreme Court actually said was, you'd need an act of Congress to do that. And, well, here's your act of Congress. This would effectively allow the president to control how many people can claim asylum at any one time in this country. Because...
In El Paso, U.S. officials were standing at the international boundary, keeping people from entering because of capacity issues. An inspector general report later found they're doing what's called metering, that's limiting the amount of people who can enter the legal ports of entry.
You have to request asylum at a port of entry. Ooh, sorry, you can't request asylum at this port of entry right now. Current law says you can either apply for an asylum at a port of entry or cross into the United States illegally and apply for asylum before or after being arrested. Which I could definitely see how one wouldn't be too thrilled with that system, but it certainly provides a check on a president operating on the dark side of the moral gray area regarding accepting asylum claims, and it helps people living here on an expired visa apply for asylum. The last thing this bill would do is say that the Attorney General shall increase the number of immigration judges by not fewer than an additional 500 judges. We currently have 350 immigration judges, so if you studied immigration law, congratulations! Your chances of being a judge have just more than doubled. Let's just hope we're not scraping the bottom of a very shallow barrel here. With that particularly intense immigration act, let's look at Ted Cruz's solution, because it's definitely more comprehensive immigration reform light. A similar solution with under half the guilt. While Lindsey's solution is focused on expanding the number of family detention centers and the amount of time you can detain families, Ted Cruz is more focused on the legal aspect and how you can get asylum claims through the system faster, so we don't have to hold families for 100 days.
We're going to have safe, secure shelters for families and expedite processing. One of the great challenges right now that makes this issue very difficult is to get an asylum case processed. It can take weeks, can take months, potentially years. That makes it very, very difficult of what to do with people in dire distress while the case is pending. That's why the legislation I've introduced dramatically accelerates the processing of these claims.
Hard to disagree with that, especially when the act is called the Protect Kids and Parents Act. I mean, I support protecting kids and parents, so I'm sure I'll love it. That's right, you only get the hottest of takes on that, that's all I have to say about that. So let's see what the Texas senator and midlife crisis Wolverine has to say about the issue. First, I could go into a mind-numbingly unnecessary amount of detail on exactly who this legislation would want to hire. But just know it would temporarily increase the number of open positions of practically every job title with asylum somewhere in its name. Ah yes, immigration law, the sector where job openings increase when people start crossing the border. These additional employees would be funded from 2019 to 2021 to help us get over this huge backlog in asylum claims. And this is where things start getting interesting, because this legislation sets up a pipeline from application to decision that would take 14 days.
Well, the Cruz bill says we're going to have a hearing in 14 days to determine asylum. Realize that shows that he has no understanding of people arriving in the United States of America who've been fleeing persecution. They do not have paperwork with them. They don't have a smartphone with them. They don't have the ability to just dial up back home and get the records they need to make their case.
Yeah, this legislation spectacularly collapsed under its own ambition and was taking heat from both sides of the aisle. Still though, the underlying logic is good and has been successfully implemented in the past to curb an asylum crisis. Now I'm about to say something I guarantee is going to offend Ted Cruz at his core. Your plan sounds just like something Bill Clinton did in the 90s. Here's the basic outline of Cruz's idea that we're going to try to port over to the 1990s. Hire a ton of judges and lawyers, set strict deadlines for approval, and any asylum claims that don't get approval are slated for expedited removal. So buckle your seatbelts and let's head back to the 90s when we were in the heat of a different asylum crisis. Although, quick warning, remember to turn your politically correct gauge back to the 90s as well. This was a time when we had Chuck Schumer going at and saying, America's asylum system is a laughingstock. These terrible gangs can tell people, we know how to get you into America. Just read this card that says, I want amnesty and you're in.
They never heard of the phrase before. They don't believe in the phrase. But they're given a little legal statement to read. And they read it. And now all of a sudden they're supposed to qualify. But that's not the reason they're here.
Aw, buddy, you were just 25 years too late to be a progressive. Jeez, what were the conservatives like in the 90s? When he was elected, the asylum backlog stood at more than 420,000 cases, which, to put that number in perspective, is about half the number of pending asylum claims reported in January of this year. So not as bad as today, but still, it was bad enough to warrant executive action. New timetables were established, and the new system met them with few exceptions. An asylum officer decision within 60 days, and an immigration judge decision within 6 months from initial filing. So definitely not a 14-day period, but better than, hey, future Steven editing this video, can we bring back an earlier graphic? I truly live in a studio apartment. A 60-day turnaround time is a lot faster than the average case pending for nearly 2 years. Much like Ted Cruz planned, it made it virtually automatic that affirmative asylum claimants whose claims were rejected by the asylum officer would immediately be placed into removal proceedings. So you might be asking, why don't we still have those policies today? Simple, solve the problem. It slowly chipped away at the backlog of asylum cases until, by the time Barack Obama became president, the asylum office's backlog was essentially gone. So why on earth would you pay a ton of money to be hyper-vigilant about a problem that's no longer there? So that's sort of the Ted Cruz-Clinton legal solution. Now finally, to the Democrat legislative solution being proposed by... nobody. Well, that certainly makes covering this a little harder. It's not like I'm the first one to notice this. The Democratic perspective is the existing laws, especially on asylum, are generally ones Democrats believe work. The administration's policies have exacerbated the situation at the border, and the statutory changes Trump is seeking would only do further damage.
You know, this is another Trump interpretation of the law. The law is very clear with respect to how we treat people who get to our borders. Our law does not say go back in Mexico and wait. Our laws say we have to acknowledge you when you get here, and we put you in a process to make sure that we examine within the fullest extent of the law exactly what is being considered.
That was Mississippi Democrat and Chairman of the Committee on Homeland Security, Benny Thompson, basically echoing the Democratic solution of defense. Defense. Let's keep this system going. Based on what I've read, the main solution, as Democrats see it, is to cut back on detentions. Let's not focus on holding every man, woman, child, and family for months or years until their day in court. Just focus on holding people who pose a credible threat to society. Now I hear some of you saying, Stephen, Mikkelinen said that 90% of asylum seekers miss their court cases. We can't just let them go. Well, there's a solution for that.
Yeah, a federal immigration official confirms that they often use those GPS ankle monitors in lieu of detaining someone in jail. And I've learned it's a practice that has only grown under the Trump administration.
It's a heck of a lot easier on the federal government's budget than providing full-time housing and three meals a day to all asylum seekers. And to go soft on you guys for a second, I'm pretty sure families would prefer that to detention as well. Democrats have tried to achieve this goal using money rather than new legislative proposals, with the fight most recently coming up when the government was shut down.
Negotiations have stalled. One of the main sticking points is the number of additional beds to give to Immigration and Customs Enforcement to detain immigrants who come across the border. Democrats have proposed reducing the number of beds, arguing that more humane policy is to let asylum seekers without criminal records be released while they await their immigration proceedings.
Of course, it's hard to argue against that too, considering under current laws, the Department of Homeland Security has had to turn away more than 125,000 illegal immigrants since December, and is on pace to release around 500,000 migrants into American communities by the end of this year. If that doesn't sound like a lot, that's the population of Sacramento! Basically, let's not kid ourselves, we're already making these judgment calls on the regular. The worry is that this leniency would cut down on the number of asylum seekers showing up to court, because why risk it? Remember, nobody's defending the status quo here. Graham is saying increase the number of detention centers and the time you can hold people. Cruz is saying make these cases quick to the point where you can get such high turnover rates that nobody gets released to the public. And Democrats are saying let's leave well enough alone. The system is working, just let families and non-dangerous individuals go free until their day in court, using either an uncontroversial enforcement mechanism, progressives aren't the biggest fans of ankle bracelets, or just trusting them to show up. Again though, we haven't seen a proposal, so I'm kinda grasping at straws here. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I'm considering doing the occasional solutions video where I lay out a problem and then look at the different proposed congressional solutions. Let me know what you think about that idea in the comments. If you want to support independent nonpartisan news, remember to subscribe by clicking on this floating logo to the left of my head. Ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching. Also, it's my birthday today, so I don't know, say hello in the comments.